In these uncertain times, I am increasingly asked if I see any of the worrying events that make up our headlines in the Bible, the book of Revelation in particular. Those questions and my own musings have prompted me to dig deeper in my studies and ponder that very question. Today I would like to share with you my thoughts and my findings. I can't help but to remember that Jesus told us to learn a parable of the fig tree. God has long likened Israel to a fig tree. We see this comparison in Hosea 9:10. The Lord said, "I found Israel like grapes in the wilderness. I saw your fathers as the first ripe in the fig tree, as her first time, but they went to Baal Peor and separated themselves unto that shame, and their abominations were according as they loved." I also remember a peculiar interaction that Jesus had with a fig tree one morning as he returned to Jerusalem. In Matthew 21, it reads, "Now in the time in the morning, as he returned into the city, he hungered. And he saw a fig tree in the way, and he came to it, and found nothing thereon, but leaves only, and said unto it, Let no fruit grow on thee henceforth forever. And presently the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, How soon is the fig tree withered away?" Why did Jesus curse the fig tree? He was hungry and wanted fruit, and found none. He found only leaves. This is an apt metaphor for Israel. God desired his nation to produce spiritual fruit, and while it had all the accoutrements of holiness, priests, temples, altars, and sacrifices, he found no fruit. In the book of Luke, Jesus actually wept over the city and gives an additional reason for its imminent destruction. That reason being that they knew not the time of their visitation, and he held them accountable for it. In Luke 19, it reads, "And when he came near, he beheld the city and wept over it, saying, If thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. For the day shall come upon thee, that thine enemy shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee round, and keep thee in on every side, and shall lay thee even with the ground, and thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation." Of course, this was prophesied of long ago. Jeremiah foretold that they would not know their Messiah and that they would reject him. The prophet said, "Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? Nay, they were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore shall they fall among them that fall in the time of their visitation. They shall be cast down, saith the Lord. I will surely consume them, saith the Lord. There shall be no grapes on the vine, nor figs on the fig tree. And the leaf shall fade, and the things that I have given them shall pass away from them." Jesus prophesied of Jerusalem's destruction and the coming diaspora in Luke 21. Jesus says, "And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which in the midst of it depart out, and let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck, in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land, and wrath upon this people. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled." Jesus said that Jerusalem would be surrounded by armies and destroyed, which happened in 70 AD, when the Roman armies led by its future emperor Titus sacked the city. He prophesied that Jerusalem would be trodden underfoot by the nations until what he called the time of the Gentiles was fulfilled. Here, we see nearly 1900 years of conquest by various nations up until Israel once again becomes a nation and inhabits Jerusalem. That finally brings us to the parable that Jesus told us we need to know. After departing the temple, Jesus' disciples came to him and asked what would be the sign of his second coming and when should the world end. He responded by describing the signs of the end of the age, reminded them of the Antichrist foretold of by Daniel the prophet, and then told them of his coming. He then concluded by telling them they should learn a parable of a fig tree. So Jesus said, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass away, till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away." This parable requires several keys to unlock, the first of which is the length of a generation. We find one answer to this in Psalms 90. "The days of our years are 80 years and 10, and if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away." The parable explains that the days of our years are 70 years. A score is 20, 80 would be 60, plus 10 would make 70. By labor and sorrow, however, one could attain 80 or 80 years. It's interesting to note that the Bible talks of a time of great tribulation and sorrow, known as the time of Jacob's trouble or the great tribulation. Our blessed hope is that Christ returns for his church when we will meet him in the clouds. Wow, what a great verse. It's loaded. I love the Psalms. We also need to understand what happens in the summer. Any good farmer worth his salt can tell you what happens during the summer, but it's also recorded for us in the Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 6 verse 8 reads, "Provideth her meat in the summer, and gathereth her food in the harvest." Proverbs chapter 10 verse 5 says, "He that gathereth in summer is a wise son, but he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame." I wonder what good wise son might come for his harvest in the summer. Keep that in mind for the next parable. Summer is for the harvest. The parable of the tares can give us some additional insight here. In theology, there is a theory called the theory of expositional constancy. That's a fancy way of saying that if the Holy Spirit uses an idiom, such as "the field is the world," it is usually used that way consistently across the Bible. I believe this is observably true as you look at the parables and prophecies throughout the scriptures. The parable of the tares is a special treat because Jesus himself unveils the meaning behind each variable in the parable. We don't have to guess or suppose. Jesus just flatly defines them here. Let's hear the parable of the tares. In the 13th chapter of Matthew, we read, "Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat, and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto them, Sir, did not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? He said unto them, An enemy hath done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares and bind them into bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn." Jesus then explains the parable starting in Matthew chapter 13, verse 36. "Then Jesus sent the multitude away and went into the house, and his disciples came unto him, saying, Declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. He answered and said unto them, He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world. The good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil, the harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. So we come out of this parable with some additional insights. We now see that we can't tell the difference between children of the kingdom and children of the devil until the harvest. The harvest is the end of the world. The reapers that separate the wicked from the righteous at the end are the angels. The sower is Jesus, and the field that will be harvested is the world. So with this new understanding, let's return to the parable of the fig tree. Israel was reborn in 1948. Summer is nigh. It is unheard of for a people dispersed to come back together from the four corners of the globe. But Israel did exactly that, as prophesied, with their original language as foretold in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord said, "For then will I turn to the people a pure language, that they may call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent." And they returned from many nations. Ezekiel chapter 20 reads, "And I will bring you out from the people, and will gather you out of the countries wherein you are scattered, with a mighty hand, and with a stretched out arm, and with fury poured out." Isaiah also tells in chapter 11, "And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from Pathros and from Cush and from Elam and from Shinar and from Hamath and from the islands of the sea. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth." They even returned with their original currency. In Ezekiel chapter 45, it reads, "And the shekel shall be 20 gerahs, 20 shekels, 5 and 20 shekels, 15 shekels shall be your mana." And probably most amazingly, they returned in a single day. Isaiah 66 reads, "Who hath heard such a thing? Who hath seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day, or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children." So when does the generation that saw the fig tree shoot forth leaves end? Well, Israel returned home in 1948. I would say this would be the fig tree sending forth leaves. Psalm 80 defines the maximum length of a generation as 80 years. If this timeline is correct, it could put Christ's return at approximately 2028. Could this timeline be accurate? Out of the 2,000 plus prophecies in the Bible, over 80% have already come to pass exactly as foretold. Those that remain largely focus on the last things, the rise of the Antichrist and the end of this age. If we look at the generation from a human standpoint, the generation certainly fits. Here in the U.S., the average person expects to live just over 78 years. The U.K. a bit better at almost 81 years of average lifespan. Japan enjoys an average lifespan for its inhabitants of approximately 84 years. 80 years would seem to be a good average. We've also seen some very interesting headlines recently regarding Israel. On December 6th of 2017, Donald Trump announced that the United States recognized Jerusalem as its capital. He did so on a jubilee year, 70 years after the State of Israel was established. 70, a number that is often associated in the Bible with punishment, restoration, and Israel. Judah was in captivity to Babylon for 70 years. The nation of Israel began with 70 Hebrews who migrated to Egypt. You'll find that in Exodus chapter 1. Moses appointed 70 elders for Israel at God's command. You'll find that in Numbers chapter 11. Jesus sent out 70 disciples to harvest the believers in Jerusalem in Luke 10. Israel's greatest leader, King David, lived 70 years as recorded in 2 Samuel chapter 5. There are even more patterns of 70 connected with Israel. The restoration of Jerusalem as Israel's capital is only the latest example. The event was historic and hints at a fully restored Israel, at least as close as it will get until its full restoration, which will be formed by an almighty God in the millennium. The Mikdash Educational Organization commemorated the historic event by minting a temple coin with Trump's visage next to Cyrus. Cyrus the Persian overcame Babylon, which at the time was considered impervious to any military threat. The city was protected by triple walls so great that chariots could be ridden across them, with the Tigris and Euphrates forming natural moats. The seemingly unconquerable city was taken without so much as a battle, exactly as the Bible foretold over 100 years prior by yet unborn Cyrus, who God named and called his servant in the 44th chapter of Isaiah. Cyrus was duly impressed with the Hebrew God, which named him and foretold his career before he was even born, so he declared that the Jews could return to Israel and rebuild their city and temple exactly as the scripture also foretold. Later, Persian rulers would promote and fund the effort and lay the groundwork for the timeline established in the 9th chapter of Daniel. But that's another study for another time. So this brings us back to the original question at hand. Was the current crisis foretold of in the Bible? Do we see any reference in the book of Revelation? Countless wars, pestilences, and earthquakes litter the pages of history. What makes this any different? There are many reasons to suspect we are nearing the end. The parable and prophets I have shared with you are but a few of the many that point in that direction. It's true that Jesus said no man knows the hour, but we are still called to be watchmen. Jesus rebuked the Sadducees and Pharisees for not knowing the sign of the times or the sign of their visitation. Are we not also called to keep watch and know the times appointed by the scriptures? Could a similar fate fall upon sleeping Christians who missed their Lord's coming, the same as the religious sects of Jerusalem did in their day? In Matthew 16, Jesus told the Sadducees and Pharisees, "When it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and lowering. O ye hypocrites, ye can discern the face of the sky, but ye cannot discern the sign of the times." Paul also reminds us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 that while the day of the Lord will come on the world like a thief in the night, we being brethren and not in darkness would not have it overtake us as a thief. Perhaps the scriptures that make me most vigilant is how God sees the role of the watchman and his accountability before God on the judgment day. In Ezekiel chapter 33, the Lord says of the watchman, "And if he sees the sword coming upon the land and blows the trumpet and warns the people, then if anyone who hears the sound of the trumpet does not take warning and the sword comes and takes him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and did not take warning. His blood shall be upon himself. But if he had taken warning, he would have saved his life. But if the watchman sees the sword coming and does not blow the trumpet so that the people are not warned, and the sword comes and takes any one of them, that person is taken away his iniquity, but his blood I will require at the watchman's hand." Do I see this pandemic in the book of Revelation? Not exactly, but as I review the prophets and the prophecies that our Heavenly Father has so graciously given us, with so much of it complete, I know that before our true King arrives, a false will appear. And he arrives peacefully in a time when the world is looking for peace and safety. Let's take a look at the four riders in Revelation 6. The first rider is on a white horse, not the true white horse rider. Not a true king, but a fake, an imposter. In his hands, he holds a bow, a tool commonly associated with war, but a bow has more than one meaning in the Bible. Revelation chapter 6, verse 2 reads, "And I saw and behold a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow and a crown, was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. This is the first seal. If we think back to the book of Revelation, God gave us a rainbow as the sign of a covenant that he would never again destroy the world by water, as was done in the time of Noah, which makes the bow an idiom for a covenant. Genesis chapter 9 says, "And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth." Daniel chapter 9 also tells us that this prince to come will confer a covenant with the people, after which he will make desolate. I believe this prince to come described in Daniel 9 and the first writer of Revelation 6 are the same. The writer also comes with a crown and he goes forth conquering and to conquer. This coming leader, this coming conqueror, will no doubt need a problem to solve to earn the affections of the world in such a short period of time. A world in despair will cry, "Peace, peace." But this false savior gives them only false security, broken covenants, and the second rider, which is war. Revelation chapter 6 verse 4 reads, "And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and that there was given unto him a great sword." This is the second seal. After the wars come shortages, inflation, and a time of scarce goods. Scarcity for some, but not for all. Not for those that follow this false Messiah. And so comes the third rider. Revelation 6, verse 5 reads, "And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, 'Come and see.' And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand." This is the third seal. And finally, following the wars and tribulations that the Antichrist uses to consolidate his power, comes death. Revelation 6, verse 8 reads, "And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death. And hell followed with him, and power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with the sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth." This is the fourth seal. Is the stage being set for the first rider? What do the days ahead hold? I don't know. I've talked to many theologians and brethren, and they point out that wars and disease are all but judgments that have happened since the beginning on a cursed world after the fall. That's certainly a safe assertion that it is absolutely true. But I think the events of the last few years, which are too great in number to review here, point to something greater. Do I know when the end will be? No. Do I know these things will come to pass by the year 2028? No. Can I say for certain that these events are connected? No. Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians that, "For now I see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even also as I am known." I do, however, find it interesting that Corona is Spanish for crown, and the world is facing financial collapse at the hands of the crown virus. I can't help but to think back to the white horse rider that shows up with a crown and a covenant in hand. The timing of the apex of this particular plague is also interesting at Passover, the time just before God led his people out of captivity, out of Egypt. It's probably also a coincidence that we have a President Trump and a crown virus crisis. Yes, possibly, all coincidence, or maybe our Father knows his children can be a little sottish and need more than a small sum of help connecting the dots. So you say, what do you know for certain? I can tell you with all certainty, Jesus Christ is my Lord and my God. If there is one thing that I pray for you to know in the uncertain days ahead, it is that the Lord Jesus Christ is your King, your High Priest, and your wonderful Chancellor and Savior. Without any doubt, if you do doubt, I tell you that today is the day to know. Know what you say? Let's look at a certain doubter, a doubting Thomas, who even walked with our Lord in his first coming. In the 20th chapter of John, verse 27, we read, "Then saith he to Thomas, Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, My Lord and my God. Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, and yet have believed." Jesus says that we that believe without seeing are blessed. He had a conversation with the Pharisees, which were the religious leaders of that day, and he told them that unless they believed that he was the I Am, they would die in their sins. The Pharisees knew what Jesus laid claim to when he said, I Am. In fact, they tried to stone him for it. Jesus said, I Am, 7 times in the book of John. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the vine, ye are the branches. I love the book of John because it is the gospel that best shows the divine nature of Christ. Jesus' life was not taken from him. He gave it for you. He had the power to give it up and the power to take it up again, which he did on the 3rd day. That's the gospel. We believe the gospel. Paul succinctly summarizes the gospel in 1 Corinthians verse 15. "For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the 3rd day according to the Scriptures." That's the gospel. That's the good news. It is a program for salvation that was put in place before the foundation of the earth for you. Where in the Bible did we first see Jesus tell us that he was the I Am? Let's think back to Exodus. In Exodus chapter 3, God tells Moses that he will deliver the Hebrew people from Egypt. And a distraught Moses asks, "Lord, how will they believe me? Who shall I say sent me?" And God tells him that he should tell them that I Am sent him. Even the portable tabernacle that the children of Israel traveled with, where the priesthood served, was a model of the Savior to come. The interior consisted of the candlesticks, called the menorah, the table of showbread, and the altar of incense, where incense was offered for intercession. This area was accessible via a door that only the priesthood could pass, and beyond this, a curtain, behind which was the Holy of Holies, the Ark, and the Mercy Seat. What did Jesus say? "I am the door. I am the light of the world. I am the bread of life." Our Lord offers intercession on our behalf to the Father. He entered into the Holy of Holies by his own blood as a final, perfect sacrifice. Jesus is the true Passover Lamb. "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last." I hope you enjoyed this Bible study. My prayer for you is that you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you don't already. If you don't know that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, now is the time to turn to him. Repent. Give God the glory. Time may be shorter than you think. Know that you can't bridge the gap between yourself and a holy God by your own power. There is no righteousness outside of Christ's righteousness, which is imputed to your account if you accept him as your Savior. Jesus Christ came to save sinners. That's great news for all of us. The Bible says that even repentance is a gift from God. If you haven't received that gift yet, I implore you to seek His face. You can do this by getting into His Word and talking with Him in prayer. There are many of you that are stuck at home right now. Rather than turn to movies, games, or other distractions, I hope you will seek the face of the true God. God bless.